We on? You lying. Are you not lying? Mm-mm. What's up, people? Welcome to Theology on Thursdays. Come on in. Oh, yeah, you live because it's a live right here. All right.
All right, wait.
Let me see. I sit.
Okay.
Starting early. With you. All right, man of God. Starting early. Listen, come on in for Theology on Thursdays. I am excited about tonight's conversation. I think we're going to have an amazing time. So if you will, when you come in, if you will like and share, what you supposed to do? Like, share,
like
and
share.
Tag three people.
React. It's actually not called like anymore.
Okay, react. So you the eCampus pastor.
I got
so
you.
Tell the people.
You need to react. You need to heart it. You need to care it. Don't sad it or anger it. Don't do that. Just make sure you like, react, comment. Let us know where you're from, where you're viewing from, and share. Like with three people.
All the things. Mish. Hey, Mish. Love you. Good to see you on tonight. Y'all got those instructions, right? Do all the things that Pastor Dashaun just said do. But we are excited to have a conversation with you tonight. We have been in our series on Dominion, number one. But deeper than that, for February, we're talking about all things relationships. And so we are marrying this idea of relationships and dominion. And I'm excited about the conversation tonight. Now, I want to see some more people come on in here. So, what's that?
Just the sauce?
Oh.
Oh, no, I'm bringing my snack.
I don't know about you.
Maybe else. Well, when I asked for a fork for my snack,
I forgot.
I was.
I'm sorry.
Fathers and sons. So, tonight, we're going to be talking about fathers and sons. Mark Lattimore, hey, man, good to see you. Good to see you. Apostle.
I see screen on. I can't see.
Tell you.
I see screen on.
Never mind. So, Pastor Deshaun is distracting me from saying what I was about to say. Now, I don't even remember what I was going to say. But what I was going to say is that as we're dealing with our fathers and sons conversation, we're dealing with it through the lens of dominion. So, again, if you will, please, come on in, tag a couple of people. I want to see y'all tagging people. And I need you all tonight to be digital evangelists so that we can have a wonderful conversation. Now, we're going to do a little teaching, but we're going to set this up conversational style. So we're going to have a really fun and inviting and engaging conversation around the topic of fathers and sons. I'm excited about the conversation. It can be taboo. We're going to answer some questions. We're going to talk about our journey. I'm going to tell y'all all the things he does wrong. No, I'm joking.
Wow.
I'm not going to do that. Wow. Only some of the things you do wrong.
Okay.
No, I'm not going to do that neither. Okay. But we're going to have, and he's going to tell you all the stuff I do wrong.
I'm not joking about that.
And I'm going to toss him right out this window. So that's how that's going to go. So look, come on in, come on in. Essie, love you. I hope you enjoyed your birthday. Great to see you. And listen, we're going to be getting started in about 75 seconds. So if you haven't, now listen, I see y'all commenting, hey, Chief, but what I haven't seen you all do is tag people yet. Y'all tag some people and get them in on the conversation. If you know anyone who's ever thought about this idea or topic of spiritual fathers and spiritual sons, this is going to be an amazing conversation to join in. Lacey, love you. Good to see you. Pastor Deshaun cannot see. Essie's still celebrating. She said she's going to catch the replay. Bless you, woman of God. We're going to have a great time tonight. Pastor Deshaun, one more time, why don't you just welcome the people and pray in. Now, you know you'd be interceding for the church. You know, just pray in. Let us know what your snack is, and let's jump in and have a conversation.
Which one I'm doing first? Pray
in. I don't know. Figure it out in the Holy Ghost.
Okay. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for the ability to talk about fathers and sons. Thank you for our time of gathering. Let hearts be open in this moment, Father. We thank you for the things that are getting ready to be shared. We thank you for our time going forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Please bless my apostle for taking and stealing my stuff, because that's not yours. Amen. I got my snack. I got my Chick-fil-A sandwich. I'm probably not going to eat it because y'all are not going to be on camera some munching like that. But I do got my snack. What you got?
So, I don't technically have a snack. This is actually yours as well.
It is.
I forgot about the snack.
Okay.
So I don't have a snack. This is macaroni and cheese from Chick-fil-A. Pastor Sherman has moved to a little bit of a plant-based diet as much as he possibly can. I'll probably cheat and get a little seafood a little bit more than her. So I got some macaroni and cheese here, but I'm not going to technically eat it unless the anointing tells me to eat it.
Who?
The anointing. That destroys your...
That's okay. Never
mind. I know what I got. Okay. Hey, listen, we're having an amazing conversation today about the topic of fathers and sons. And I'm excited about this conversation because it's a taboo conversation. There are a lot of questions around it. What we're aiming to do tonight is to talk about it from a scriptural lens, but also our journey. Pastor Dashaun and I have been in alignment and covenant relationship for a little over 3 years. We met, he came to the first service for, at the time, Destiny Center, and he has not left. He's wanted to leave. I wanted to push him out, but he didn't leave, and I didn't push him out. And it's going to be a part of the journey. Did I lie?
You don't get somebody. Did I lie? Didn't want to leave.
Did you just lie?
Yes.
Yeah, you did lie. Come on out. All right, but we're going to use our journey. We're going to talk about scripture, talk about it from a scriptural standpoint, but I think it'll be a very, very beneficial conversation. We're going to teach through it, but it'll be more of a conversation. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 is where I'm going to really launch our thought from to give us a scriptural understanding, if you will, this idea of spiritual father, spiritual son relationship. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 15 says this, "For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you shall not have," Lord, the apostles in the room, "yet you shall not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel." One more time. "For though you may have 10,000 instructors, mentors, teachers, yet you shall not have many fathers. For in Christ I have begotten you through the gospel." Now, our premise for our conversation is this reality, that spiritual relationships are beautiful and amazingly beneficial when they are done right. All right, we're going to say that again. Spiritual relationships are beautiful and amazingly beneficial when they are done the right way. What is the right way? When it's God-honoring, when it's healthy, when it's mutually beneficial. We're going to talk a lot about that tonight. When it's mutually beneficial and when it's rooted in love, okay? So we're talking again about this idea of spiritual fathers and spiritual sons. Paul says you have not many fathers. Now, here are some scriptural examples of spiritual father, spiritual son relationship. We see Elijah and Elisha as a model. I want to say that this is only one model. And a part of the abuse that we've seen in spiritual father and spiritual son relationships, we've tried to make everybody the Elisha. And we put all of these restrictions, if you will, on people, or boundaries, if you will, or rules on people to function the way Elijah and Elisha did. However, that's only one model that we find. So we say things like, well, Elisha washed the hands of his servant. Yeah, but there are other models where that didn't happen. So we can't build rules around one model. We've got to find the synchronization of the principles to find how we to engage this thing.
Yeah.
But Elijah and Elisha, they are one model. We also see Paul and Timothy. Paul, who says, stir up the gifts that are on the inside of you but from the laying on of hands. Because as Paul, as the father, laid hands on Timothy and released and imparted gifts that came from him. God, I don't like that. Came from him. Another one, we see Moses and Joshua. Now, Moses and Joshua is an interesting one because when Joshua is first mentioned in the scripture, I don't even know if you have ever talked about this. Maybe we did.
I don't think we did.
But when Joshua is first mentioned in the scripture, it says Joshua, the son of Nun, because that's his biological father. As the process continues, it ends up saying Joshua, the son of Moses. Yeah. All right. There's another model. And then there's Saul and David. That's also a model, and we know how that turned out. But we believe in this concept of spiritual father, scriptures, and relationships because one of the leading characteristics of God is his fatherhood dynamic. So this comes from the beauty of God's fatherhood dynamic. Let's talk a little bit about our journey and how we came into alignment. Let's share your piece of that puzzle.
He took me from where I was at. kidnap me. Okay. I know. Here, let me start off with
food. I almost spit this water all over this table.
What year was that? 2021? We started in 2021?
The church?
Yeah. Well, technically, y'all started in 2020. But y'all
had the church planting journey. Yes, we started in 2020. You came to the first service. Prior to that, though, like a couple of weeks before that, I had to preach Melvin Thompson's church, and Essie brought you with her.
Mm-mm, that was December. November, I came to the service.
Uh-uh.
Yes, it was.
Before, okay. Clearly, we didn't practice.
Listen.
Clearly, we didn't practice. Here's what happened.
Oh, God.
Okay.
I wish Essie was preached.
I preached a message about
faith in the middle of frustration. I'm not forgetting.
I did not start. That was before I started the church.
Oh, God.
I'm telling you. Here's what's going to happen. When we finish this, I'm going to go to the live on Melvin Thompson's page, because one thing y'all know about me, I have a very photographic memory. That was before I launched the church, because after that, Melvin Thompson came to me and asked me, were you connecting? I said, I don't know. I didn't launch the church at that time. It was prior to. So let's skip past that detail, because you got that wrong.
She did.
Yeah, she tells our story about how she came into alignment with me wrong, too. So
no, it's you. You're coming back here.
Go ahead here and go past that part.
Whatever. All right. So, yeah, you preach. Let me skip over that part, apparently. But there is a part I have to say. Because after the first initial service I came, one of the first things you said to me was stay close. You just kept repeating it to me, and I didn't understand.
No, that was at the long service.
That was at the long service.
You got that right. Keep going.
Okay, I can tell.
Okay,
apostle. Anyway, so, yeah, you preached a message. It was, I'm not forgotten, because I remember posting it, December. I joined December 17th. That was November. Joined December 17th. We had our first ministry trip to where? Clearwater, Florida? In March.
You're doing all right.
While we were in Florida.
Hush up, Chief. Keep going.
While we were in Florida.
Your job is to tell the story. Now look at
you. I got to do both. I'm going to eat campus. This is my campus. I don't see y'all a mile. So after we were in Florida, the Lord brought me to a dream of me having bags in my hand, crying in between Apostle Cheryl and Apostle Dwayne, well, pastors at that time. And I thought nothing of it. I text CP.
Who's that?
CP is Elder Durrell, formerly known here as CP, we had different dynamics. He was my brother at the time, and then, you know, that's the whole thing. But anyway, so I did that. I told Pastor Dwayne, and after that, it was history. Everything just started speeding up after that. I moved in June 2021, came down here, moved. My first day here was June 5th. Of 2021. I came down here at the same time Shushu did, but we're talking about us.
Who's that?
Shushu is my uncle, your brother.
This is that.
Terrell.
Thank you. What's wrong?
The people don't know that. That's not.
Y'all funny. Better know who Shushu is, because he's Shushu and the old Siki out of my high. Anyway.
Everybody don't go to death.
Yes. Okay. So Shushu, Terrell, what's his last? Rashawn, that's his artist name.
Just keep
Yes. Anyway. So I moved here in June, and from there, it's been pretty good. So that's the connecting point.
It is. So I remember we had a first conversation virtually. I was actually in Jersey, and I was just trying to get to know him. And he said, I ain't trying to say I got a father and all that. And I said, well, who said that to you? I don't remember having a conversation with my father. I'm trying to get to know you as your pastor. Point being that one of the things that we do, we make every relationship, every person that comes to the church, we try to force people into categories, but I think that's unhealthy.
Yeah,
It needs to be God-led and God-ordained, these type of relationships. One of the things that happened for Pastor Dashaun and I, both of us had a spiritual sense and understanding of what God was doing. It wasn't anything that I dreamt up. It wasn't anything that Pastor Dashaun dreamt up. We sensed the Lord, and then we came into this particular covenant relationship, and God has been faithful, and we'll continue to talk a little bit more about that. Talk a little bit about the job of the spiritual father. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the job of the spiritual father, and Pastor Dashaun is going to talk about the job of the spiritual son, because both parties have a job. Both parties have things that they are called to do in the relationship that you need to know. The father needs to know the son. Not only does the father need to know the father's job description, the father needs to know the son's job description. Not only does the son need to know the son's job description, the son also needs to know the father's job description. So here are a couple of things. It's not an exhaustive list on either side. Yes.
No.
Right. here's not an exhaustive list, but number one, fathers, spiritual, we're talking about tonight, and natural, but fathers provide. They provide direction. They provide counsel. They provide wisdom. They provide correction. They provide a future. They provide an inheritance. It's a part of what spiritual fathers do. Spiritual fathers provide. If you are a spiritual father, there must be something that you are giving and not just receiving. And I want to say that because this culture of spiritual parenting and leadership abuse is really what it has been, is that the father or the mother or the bishop or the apostle finds themselves in a position where all they do is receive while the son serves their life away. And I don't believe that's true on any level. We're going to talk, you're going to hear us say this a lot, that these type of relationships need to be mutually beneficial. If you are in a relationship with a spiritual parent and they are not providing anything and it's only you, it is not biblical and it's not godly and it's not healthy. Number two, fathers protect. Number one, fathers provide. Number two, fathers protect. They protect against the snares of the enemy. They protect against even the son's own proclivity that the son may or may not be aware of. The fathers protect from the plan of the enemy, the devices of the enemy. One thing that I will do is I will see somebody comment on Pastor Deshaun's wall or post on Facebook, and I said, watch that person. I sense this. Hello? Okay. I'll do it in a heartbeat. Why? Not because I need to be in everybody's business, but it's my job to protect. It's my job to watch, and it's my job to see ahead of where he sees. Y'all follow that? So number one, fathers provide. Number two, fathers protect. Number three, fathers provide a pattern. So Pastor Deshaun should be able to look at my life, not just spiritually, and see a pattern for how he can move about in his future. Now, nobody's perfect, but one of the things about D3 calls D4 Shayshawn. One of the things about Pastor Deshaun is that he has the unique privilege and maybe even vice of watching my life up close. So he doesn't just watch me preach. He also watches how I engage my family. He watches how I treat my wife. He watches how I treat my children. And he watches my prayer life, my consecration. And the goal should be that it's providing a healthy, a responsible, and a godly pattern for how he should live, and engage his life. The goal should be that it's providing a healthy pattern. Now, the other side of that, because I'm human, he also gets to watch my failures. And one of the things about the father, in our particular case, I'm very open with him about the fact that when I don't do well, when I miss the mark. I remember a particular moment when your spiritual mother, Pastor Cheryl, I don't remember what it was, but she was upset with me about something. I don't remember what it was. Believe it or not, I'm not perfect. I know. I know y'all are shocked. Go ahead and wow. I want to see the wild comments right there. I'm not perfect. And so one day, Pastor Cheryl was upset with me about something. I mean, it wasn't a big deal. But after I fixed it, the first thing that I did, because Pastor Deshaun was around, was I talked to him about it. I told him what I, you remember that?
Yeah, I do. I was thinking about that.
I told him what I did. I said, hey, I missed it here. I think I forgot a date about something. And I said, and this is what I did to fix it. And the reason I did that is because I wanted him to see my humanity. I also wanted him to see what I did to fix it and go above and beyond to ensure that my family stays intact. Because they provide a pattern. So fathers provide, they protect, they give a pattern. Fathers also prophesy. Fathers prophesy. So a part of what should happen in a spiritual father-spiritual son relationship is that the son should be able to hear the voice of the father speak concerning his future or his or her future. Because when we're talking about this idea of sonship, we're not relegating it to gender specific. Now, next week, I believe, Apostle Cheryl and Chief, or Pastor Sean Tate, they're going to have a conversation on the other side of this with spiritual mothers and spiritual daughters, and that'll be great. So make sure you tune into that too. But fathers also prophesy the future, the destiny, the direction, the map, and the roadmap of the future of the son. That way, as the son moves into his future, he begins to have language for it based upon the word of the Lord that has been released from the Father. What does this do? When challenges come, when moments come, the son gets to lean back onto, well, my father gave me this word, so this is going to be the end result. It actually happened today.
It did.
You thought about it? It actually happened today. We were having a text message conversation, and what I began to do was prophesy the end of the thing. Why? So that he could anchor himself in the word of the Lord from his father. Here's the last one that I'll share. So number one, provide. Number two, protect. Number three, a pattern. Number four, prophesy. Number five, the father prevents. The father prevents destruction. The father prevents the proclivities of the son from taking over. We look at fathers in the Old Testament. One of the things that the father did was circumcise the son. And that's still spiritual for today. A part of what father's doing is preventing, because what does the circumcision do? It prevents disease. It prevents unwanted things happening in the body. Now, from a spiritual context then, you look like you learned it while we did this.
I am.
I love that. He's a student. Stay a student. One of my mentors says, stay spongy.
Yeah.
I love that word. Stay spongy. But they prevent destruction. They circumcise the heart of the son, the ambitions of the son, the motives of the son, the proclivities of the son, to ensure that as he moves about his life and his future, that he has, to the best of the father's ability, a fail-proof destiny. Challenges will come along the way, roadblocks, stumbling blocks, but the continual preventing and circumcision buffers and protects and insulates the son. What do you think about that? What do you think about that?
I think it's mutual to the job of the son. Not most of it, but about 50-50 there about mutual beneficial.
Talk to us. So you're going to talk about what now?
The job of the son.
The job of the son. So that was the job of the father. Let's talk about the job of the son.
So you said the job of the father is to, one of them was to provide and protect. But for, as a son, as you are, from a father's standpoint, as you are giving to us, as we are feeding, one of the things that we're supposed to do and are called to do is to steward the correction and the investment that you give us.
Say that again.
Steward the correction as an investment.
Say it one more time.
Steward correction.
And I'm only saying it because that was good.
As investment.
So steward correction as an investment.
Yes.
Boy, that's good.
Because there's an instance that I was thinking about. There was the first Destiny Summit. I'm not going to say that they everything I have to y'all be nosy. But there was a time where you and CP had brought me into a FaceTime call. And we had talked about a whole situation that happened during Destiny Summit. And I had to decide in that moment if I was going to be offended and leave, or if I was going to be a son and submit and change what I was doing. In fact, I believe we had another day of service to go. I think it didn't even... Okay, that's not the point. But the point is...
I thought we waited.
I think you waited, he didn't wait. So that I got a text from him,
that sounds
and then I got a FaceTime call.
That sounds
But yeah, so part of the son's duty is to steward in correction as investment because, and I think you taught me this, no one gives correction where they're not invested in the first place.
Absolutely.
Or no one gives investment where, or how does the Bible say, you don't cast your pearls among swine.
It's true. There are people in my life that I have decided that I will not correct anymore. And that's not a good thing.
It's not, especially as a son.
Absolutely.
So if you're there as a son in that place, at some point you have to have a conversation so you can pivot, one, with the father, but two, you got to see what's going on in yourself because that's just a weird space to be in.
So how does that work when you disagree?
How does that work when you disagree with the father's standpoint? Mm-hmm. I don't agree with you all the time.
I know.
And so what that does for me is I have to sit with one Holy Spirit, and then I also have other people outside of your voice. To bounce it off of. If
that compliment my voice.
That compliment your voice, that are not contrary to your voice, but they know, they either, one, have your ear as well, and they are trusted by you, which is a big thing. They're trusted by you and Apostle Cheryl. Mm-hmm. And I talk to them, I bounce it off of them, because typically, most of the time, if you surround yourself by people who will just agree with you, you're always going to be wrong and stay in the fence. Where if my person is Elder Darrell CP, where I bounce it off of him and I said, hey, I feel this. Dad said A, B, C, D, E, F, G. I don't agree with it. And then typically by the end of the conversation, I'll either have resolved that this is what it is and this is what I have to agree with in this moment, and or I have to pivot. Typically, most of the time, I come out of the fact that I do have to pivot, regardless of if I agree or not.
Beautiful. I hope y'all are listening. Keep liking and sharing. This is a great conversation. This man dropping nuggets. He got something. All right, Pastor Dashaun, give us some, please.
So we have the first point, stewarding correction as investment. Then we want to come back to the fact that as a son, if you are a son of a pastor, a son of a leader, you have to steward the father's house. You have to serve, in a sense. I won't go into scripture, but Luke 3 and 38, basically, it talks about how Adam was a son of God. It proves to him that there was a son and father, not the son of God, but the son of a son of God.
Sure.
It goes on to tell, basically, like Adam was a son of God. And in Genesis 2 and 5, it says that God took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Mm-hmm. And so while Adam was placed in his father's garden, one of his main primary responsibilities was to keep and protect and guard what his father was called to.
So let's bring some practicality to that. Okay. Talk about how you serve Apostle Sherlock's life briefly.
Briefly, yes. Okay. I'm about to say this.
Yeah, because that's a lot. Yeah. Just talk about, because a part of what I want in this conversation, especially for the son's side in this, I want the people to see that we're not just having a conversation that you don't live out.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that you get it right 100% of the time, because I don't either. Mm-hmm. But you do your best to live this out. So what does that look like? How do you steward the father and, in your case, the father and mother's house?
I think one of the first things I do is see where there's a need. Wherever there is a need, if a son can fill it. You cannot, and I say this all the time, I actually said this on Friday. You could not have told me 2-3 years ago that I'm a graphic designer. There was a need in the church. And
now that
I feel
y'all, this boy has a whole business that pays him money.
Couldn't tell me.
Just because there was a need in our house. That's literally what happened. We needed a graphic designer for some in-house things, and that boy sat down, and the anointing came on him to catch the moment of the need. Yeah. That then opened up economy for his life and for his future. Now that's crazy.
Oh, my body's
did
on
you,
the floor.
Did you flip?
I did.
Mm-hmm. It literally happened that way. But you know what I also want to say, because I knew you weren't going to say this part, and it's okay, but I wanted to say this part. He does that, and many times Apostle Sherlock and I don't even know it. So there are things that he does serving our lives, serving a house, serving our family, all of those things, and sometimes we don't even know it. We find out after down the line, somebody else may say it to us. Why? Because, and I posted a little about this, there's a difference between an opportunist and a servant and a son, and it can really look the same,
yeah,
right? But a lot of what Pastor Dashaun does with stewarding the father and mother's house, we don't even know about it. Let me also say he's not the only one that serves us that way. He's just the only one that's having this conversation with us today. We have some amazing sons and daughters. I have a son sitting behind the camera right now. We have amazing sons and daughters in our lives. He's just the one having here. Conversation with. What else?
So part of that, before I move on, part of that is the fact that sons really don't want or seek a platform. One of the things you said about, I actually taught theology on Thursday for the first time today last year.
What?
Yes.
Dance
around that table. You don't want me to do that. So I taught it last year because I believe you were out of town. I think you were in Trinidad, or you were out of state or country, I believe. Apostle Shaw had a whole bunch of things going on. I saw there was a need. I filled it. I didn't want to do that, but the fact that there was a need, I had to fill that. And one of the things you said about
now you got a whole lot to work.
I don't. That's,
now you're bad. That
you
stuff.
You must. You must listen. One of the things that you said about me in that moment was the fact that my platform would grow from that moment, but it wasn't because that's what I was seeking. And I think that's what you were saying about the opportunists versus the people who actually serve as sons instead of people who are serving you. Amen. Let's move on. The third point I have here.
Pastor Mike said, you big time now, man of God.
That's
big time.
First point was stewarding correction as investment. Second point is stewarding the father's house. Our third point is to cover the father.
Okay.
I kind of read this to give context real fast. Basically, in Genesis 9, 20 through 23, Noah was I believe he was drunk, to basically give the AMP version.
Yes.
I believe he was drunk.
Real
bad, actually. So, let's see. Who was it? Ham saw it. Saw the nakedness of the father, and basically him and his brother went to cover the nakedness of his father. As his son, especially in this dynamic, one of the things I actually would like to see you do is to teach him the dynamics of a son, the different levels of sonship. But if you are this close, and if you are a son, period, one of the things you have to do is be able to handle your father's humanity and understand, what's this saying you say to me? Take the meat, spit out the bone? Or... And one of the things you pray when you're praying for me is say everything that is good. And one of the things you have to do, especially as a son, is balance the man and the mantle. And understand that they are the same, but they come with different
nuances.
Yes, nuances, bro, could be stuff like
now,
that.
Now, let me say this, though, because we can't say this. We got to make sure we say it responsibly, not that you're saying it irresponsibly. But what some people can hear is that the son has to tolerate the irresponsible nature of the father, and that's not what we're saying here, right? You can't just live immoral, and like you just can't have an immoral life, because what I've noticed is that the liberties of the father can become the proclivities or destruction or death of the son.
One more time, say it for me.
The liberties of the father
yeah.
can become the proclivity or destruction or death of the son. So it looks like you see me smoking a cigarette and then you go smoke crack.
Whoa.
I said it. Hello, right? So we're not making an excuse for living immoral. What we're talking about is the reality that we're all working out our soul salvation. However, in that, a part of what the son has to see is working out my soul salvation through my humanity, not me just living immoral, because that does the opposite of what we talked about. We talked about providing a pattern and preventing, because if he sees me living immoral, that becomes a pattern. He said, oh, I see him living immoral, and then I'm going to go, and he go preach. The anointing still come, the anointing still fall. Okay, then he going to go do it. Well, the problem is, what he doesn't see is the judgment that I'm under from God. Yeah. Right? So I just wanted to, that was good. What else you got?
I have one more point, but then I have a caveat after this. But one more, sons are also supposed to remain honorable. Everybody knows the scripture, what? You know, everybody doesn't know it, but it says, honor thy father and thy mother, for, which is the first commandment with the promise. And one of the things, which goes back to managing both the man and the mantle, is regardless of what I see, or regardless of what you allow me to see in that moment, I have to be able to still place and apply honor where culture or other people would say to either leave or be offended or talk or gossip. One of the things honor does is give... What's this word with an S? Discretion. It gives discretion because honor doesn't uncover, or honor doesn't do the contrary to the opposite antithesis of what love is. So if you give...
So look, y'all, there are times when I mess up at this church and y'all don't know that it's me that messed up, because he covers it. And he'll take the blame for it like it was him, but it was really me, because I'd be forgetting stuff.
I'm going to say something after, though.
And I'm about to say it. Good point. You can't beat me. So what's the point?
Okay.
I'm just telling you what the Lord loves.
Amen. last thing I'll say is, before we talk about it, because we talked about everything that the father-son dynamic is, we'll talk about what's not. The last thing I'll say is, as a son, you've said it earlier about giving a blueprint. You have to read the blueprint. What that looks like is...
Because you're teaching me, too.
Okay, what that looks like is...
And the reason I'm saying that, not because you don't know it, but I don't know if all the time fathers know that they can learn from the son as well.
That's good.
We learn from each other.
Mutual.
Right.
I understand.
Go ahead.
If you are, as a son, you have to read from the blueprint, because if your father is doing all this, say this correctly, if you're giving all this impartation, if you're doing all this teaching, and you're spending all these times, something has to come out of it. So one of the things specifically for you... Everybody, if you're a worship leader, if you're an apostle, if you are an entrepreneur, that doesn't mean that I'm all that.
What that means is I take the principles out of your life. One of the things you say is, I say this right, models are many, principles are few, models always change, principles never do.
Good job.
Is, so taking that and applying it here is, you may be a worship leader, that doesn't mean I can sing. What that means is I take the dimension, but I can't hold a tune. Okay, so before you say whatever you're about to say. So in that sense, you take the dimension out of what you live in. So like you said earlier, I do take the fact that you live a life of prayer. And I do take the fact that you do live a life of purity. And you are willing, one of the things you said to me, is going the long route. I forget who said it, but one of the preachers said the senior group. And so, yeah, that's basically what the son is supposed to do. Do those three. But most of all is to make sure you're reading the blueprint.
You long with it like your spiritual mother. All right. Job of the father.
She's not here.
The job of the son. What spiritual father and son relationships are not? Here's the first thing that we'll say. What spiritual father and son relationships are not, number one, they're not a necessity for everybody. Not church culture and kingdom. Church culture has taught us that everybody needs to have a spiritual father and it's a rule and it's a law, and it's not. Not everybody does need a voice. You need somebody that can tell you no, yes, hush, be quiet, maybe not yet, whatever the case may be. But this idea of spiritual fathering, spiritual parenting is not a necessity. You may be one that decides you don't have a spiritual parent and you're not going to hell for that. You may just have a mentor, you may just have a pastor, you may just have an apostle and a leader. There are some people that do not have spiritual parents. And guess what? It's okay.
It is.
So number one, it's not for everybody. You can start number two.
Wow.
It's right there, man of God.
No, okay. Wow. I give it a breath. It's not for everybody, and it's also not abuse and or slavery. So what that could look like is you will never outdo applicable sense. You will never do something that, you will never ask me to do something that you will not do yourself. That's absolutely. But basically, there's a difference between sonship and slavery. And it's not serving from a sense of you got to do this, you got to do this, and there's no benefit. But like we said earlier, that goes back to the mutual benefit of the father and the son.
I also never inconvenience you for the sake of inconveniencing you, because I just get the right in the name of authority.
Yeah.
Right? So if I ask you to do something, most of the time before I ask you to do something, unless it's a dire emergency, I'm going to ask what you have going on. And I'm going to make sure that your schedule is okay and clear. And the thing about that is, because I know you and I know your heart, even if you're not free, you'll find a way to make yourself free because of your honor, and I still don't require that of you.
Yeah.
Right? Pastor Dashaun serves this ministry, and there are times when we call him and we say, hey, you're fired for 2 weeks. No ministry. Hello?
I haven't got fired in a while. I'm doing good.
You're doing all right. No ministry. No serving. Why? Because you as a person, you are much more important to me than anything you will ever do.
Yeah.
Right? And so we've created this abuse slavery dynamic in spiritual parenting where the son is serving his life away until one on that great getting up morning when you may get something in return, or your reward is in heaven. Well, yeah, that's true, but what about here in the earth? Right? And it's just taking on such an abusive culture and a slave mentality when it comes to spiritual father, spiritual son, and it's not that on any level. One of the things that we try to make sure, Apostle Sean and I try to make sure we do in our son, with our spiritual children, is that we are serving them just as much as they serve us. Now, it may look different. That might be serving you through prayer. It might be serving you through, but we try to make sure that the people that are serving us don't feel that it's about us.
Yeah.
And so we know how to say, nah. We know how to say, sit down. We know how to say, take a break, because it's not abuse and slavery. Which leads to the next one, which is really tied to that spiritual father-son relationships are not one-sided. We've been talking about that part all night, that they are not one-sided, that both parties should benefit from the relationship. I benefit so much from Pastor Dashaun, but he also gets the benefit from me. Because he serves the way that he does, I don't get to... Okay. I can't find another example, so I just can't say it. Okay. But because he serves, I'm always available for him to the best of my ability. Okay? What's the next
one? Yeah, I'm going to take that from you. Amen. The next one, but it's not, is spiritual parenting, or especially spiritual fathering, does not replace natural parents. Does not.
Pastor Dashaun has a natural father, and I ain't trying to take his job.
I do. And it doesn't mean specifically, I'm not going to stay here too long, but we sometimes, especially as sons who don't have fathers, not my testimony, but if sons who don't have fathers, we often look for something to fill it, and that's where we get that abusive slave mentality of, this is my father. That's how we're talking about, but it's not meant to replace your natural parents. And one of the things you do well, and mom does well, is you make sure, and I don't really struggle with this, but honoring my natural parents.
Absolutely.
While we have a close dynamic, you are not my natural parent. And and you actually don't want to be. So that's a good
thing. I have five kids. I'm not trying to do that. No, really. We support it. We honor it. Now, there are, like you said, this is not your scenario, but there are scenarios where we our spiritual parents, Apostle Shirley and I, to people who don't have the greatest relationship with their parents. And we try to fill the voids that we have the capacity to fill. But the other thing that we do is try to see how we can support the reconciliation of the natural parents, because we believe in it. And our job is not to replace, but it is to come alongside and create that village and that support. Your father and I actually have a relationship. We text and talk. And not about you sometimes.
Love
right?
I love that.
Like, we have our own relationship. I love Deshaun's father. I love his mother. I have a relationship with his father. And it's a village that we are after to support. And when Deshaun gets a little crazy, Pastor Deshaun gets a little crazy, and it doesn't happen often, his dad will call me and say, hey, pop him upside the head for me. Or, you know what I mean? Because we have that relationship. So it's not meant to replace natural parents. Here's the last one. It's not meant to stroke the ego of the father. So Pastor Deshaun being a spiritual son of mine is not a ticket on my shoulder that makes me special. Oh, I got spiritual children. I got spiritual son. None of that. Paul says this statement, and this is probably, I'm gonna say it again in a second, but Paul says this statement about laboring until Christ is formed. So it's an honor. It's a burden, if you will. It's a sober thought in reality that somebody trusts you enough to come into a kingdom relationship with them to say, I trust you as a spiritual parent, that I trust you to help steward my destiny, for me to be a part of your DNA, for me to allow you to labor into Christ's form. It's not about an ego. It's an honor. And we just got to take some of this hierarchical pride stuff out of this. And we got to bring some or balance to it. So here's a couple of principles, and we're out of here for tonight. I hope you all are enjoying this. Number one, a couple of principles. God uses spiritual father and son relationships to extend his legacy in the earth. Notice what I said. Extend his legacy in the earth. Here's why. Because while I have a legacy in the earth, my legacy as a spiritual father in the earth is only a byproduct of my heavenly father's legacy in the earth. So I don't need people to look, now it happens because of relationship, but I don't need people to be, when people see Pastor Deshaun, now they say it, oh my God, you sound like Whitehead. Somebody said you Whitehead's baby. And I thought that was hilarious, right? But I don't need people to see me, I need people to see Christ.
Yeah.
And my job is being fulfilled when people can look at you and say, I see him growing into the man Christ has ordained him to be. Notice I said man. Because part of what people try to do with you is make you a little kid, and I hate it. And we got to be careful of that. He's not everybody's nephew. So y'all stop all that nephew talk. He's a grown man. I don't even call him son in public. I call him Pastor Deshaun.
I'm going to get to, I got the mic now. Thank you so much. Woo! The next thing we got is God uses these relationships also to provide boundaries and parameters. What that looks like is, yes, you can have a pastor, but sometimes your father, or sometimes you don't always have a pastor, sometimes you just have a father. And in that sense, if you know
your father can't do something, or your father doesn't allow his flesh to do certain things, then you get to look at that life and say, okay, I don't get to do A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And it kind of gives you a, like you said, boundaries and parameters of how to live my life. Because if I get to watch, like we said earlier, if I get to watch my blueprint live his life or live her life, then I have a framework for how I should live mine.
You know, the catch to boundaries and parameters is that it's not comfortable.
Yeah.
One of the conversations that I've always had with Pastor Dashaun is, and he does well with it, is I always, and he just said it earlier, I always emphasize the importance in him being okay with taking the long route. Apostle Cheryl and I, while we are young, we have an extensive process, if you will, of ministry and training that's still not over, right? We have given our time to development and processing. And we have seen the detriment of not having those boundaries and parameters. Pastor Dashaun could look at his journey and say, wow, I could be doing this, that, and the third, and he could. But because of boundaries and parameters, there are things that he's just not doing that he could. So he could, now he has an itinerant ministry, he travels, he preaches, he does all of that. But one of our conversations around the boundaries and parameters, do all of that, but finish your degree.
Yeah.
And one of the things to his credit as a son is that he's listened to the counsel and the feedback around boundaries and parameters. Don't build an itinerant ministry yet. Get your degree. Get a great job. Learn to save money. Build your credit. He's done all of those things. And he has an itinerant ministry. And because of that, because he's submitted to the boundaries and parameters, he's growing as a man as a tall tree. He should be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth the fruit in his season. It's because he submitted to the boundaries and parameters. We have two more, and we up out of here. And we said this before, we're just kind of re-emphasizing and bringing it all together. God uses these relationships as models and templates. My job is to be a healthy, responsible model. I am the product of dropped sonship. You are the product of dropped sonship. And we don't say that from an unhealed place. We don't say that to speak negatively about anybody that we've ever served, but it has been our reality. So one of the things that we've tried to make sure that we do in our context is get it right. That's something that's a part of our heart. Hey, let's get it right and let's model this. Let's model what kingdom family looks like, kingdom relationship looks like, where we honor each other. I honor you as a son of mine, but I also honor you as a grown man. So there are certain ways that I will never talk to you because I'm not going to degrade you as a man, although you submit to me as your father. You are a man, right? Yeah. And so there's a way that I need to engage and approach another grown man, right? But we create models and templates. And what's the last one? Can we wrap up?
Last one is kind of reiterating everything we just said, is God uses these relationships as a defense mechanism for destinies. I stuttered over it, so I'm going to say it again.
Did you see how I put it in my notes?
Whatever he said, I was actually laughing. God uses these relationships as defense mechanisms for destinies. So what does that look like? God gives us our boundaries. He gives us our parameters. He gives us a father who can see ahead of us and say, don't go that way, or don't do this, don't say this, don't act like this, don't do this. One of the things you teach me in our, not hearkening, that's a hard word, but teaching and speaking to me about is manhood. So while you're teaching all that, you're not worried about just my gifts, you're worried about my manhood, because that's what brings me for the longevity of my gifts, my itinerant ministry, or what have you.
It's real.
It is.
Honor it. God did it.
Okay. Submission. See? but yeah, that's all I have.
So that's our conversation.
It is.
Really, again, it's a taboo conversation. A part of Apostle Cheryl and I's responsibility in the earth is to model what healthy spirituality looks like in all sense of that word. Family, home, all of these dynamics. And this is just a part of that conversation. And the reason we talk about this from the lens of dominion, because of my father in the gospel, Apostle Melvin Thompson uses this phrase, generational dominion. Yeah. And it's the passing of the faith, the passing of the mandate from one generation to another to ensure that God's legacy is accomplished. And if we're going to do that successfully, we've got to get it right in relationships. Pastor Shane, Pastor Dashaun and I don't always agree. Sometimes we get on each other's nerves. Sometimes we have to navigate through our humanity, through our life, through different opinions, or whatever the case may be. But we're bonded together by covenant, and neither one of us get to walk away. We're committed to doing it God's way, and we're committed to seeing the fullness of this expression modeled in the earth. And again, he's not the only one. Zay is sitting behind the camera, y'all. He's an amazing son. We have Chief. I see Essie on. I see Jazz on. We have some amazing spiritual children in the earth. But a part of Apostle Sherlin and I's assignment is to create a model that can that we can represent to the earth. And we're not the only people doing it, but to represent to the earth to say that we can get this right. So, Pastor Dashaun, I love and honor you as a son. I really do. I'm grateful that you're a part of my life. I benefit so much from you. I learn so much from you. I get to text you when I'm having a bad day and say, you know what, pray for your father. Or I'm feeling this. I'm building this, whatever the case may be. And you've been a safe place. Like you say that I am to you, you have equally been to me. And I will never be in a position where I don't honor you for who you are. You are not a slave. You are not a peasant. You are a man that's royal, that's worthy of double honor because you're a leader in your own right, which is why we can trust you with so much of our vision and so much of our life and even our children. Why? It's because of your place of honor. So I love you and thank you for taking this journey with me. And I'll give you the final words and you can do your thing, your eCampus thing and raise off and all that fun stuff.
Amen. I'm not going to say that back to you because I might get weepy. Y'all not going to get me on this camera. So I hope you guys enjoyed the conversation tonight. One of the things that you, it's very imperative, especially in these moments like these, is to sow into good ground. In the comments, I believe, they are going to put the ways to give.
If not, you can just say it.
If not, I'm going to try to remember them. One of the ways is text to give. Text any amount to 84321.
I do remember that part.
I do remember that. Cash App is $ Destiny Global. There's one more.
Is it Destiny Global or Destiny Global Church?
Destiny Global Church. Destiny Global.
You sure?
Woo! Destiny Global Church. I just gave my tithes today. It'll seek you out, obviously.
Destiny Global Church.
That's about it, though. You want to pray out? Is that pray there?
Mm-hmm. You can pray out. It's okay.
Your campus. Amen.
Chief said Destiny Globe Church.
Destiny Globe Church. Amen. Cool. So next time.
Any questions? Oh. Are there any questions that we can answer? We'll take about 3 minutes. So get them in if you got them. And if you don't, then amen. Any questions? Anything that we can answer? We are not the authorities on this subject, but we are doing our best to get it right, and we're doing all right. Blessed be the name of our God. Any questions before we jump off? 30, 29, 28, 27. Y'all get something out of this? All right. His attention span is to have you.
Okay. Don't take much from me. Okay.
He was
gone. I don't think I see any questions, bro.
You don't see any questions? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, let's wrap.
All right. So, Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about fathers and sons. Thank you for the grace that has been on this conversation that is getting ready to hit the viewers. Father, thank you for exposing them to a new level of father sonship, even with you, Father. I thank you and I bless you that even as they travel throughout their week, that times of reflection gets to happen in their personal time. And I thank you that in this moment, you introduce yourself to them as Abba Father. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you.
Love y'all. Peace.